Hello, everyone. Let's continue with the next topic, that is the code word space. We are just looking at this diagram, we'll be able to make out that if we have the message vector size as 4 bits, for example, the total number of combinations possible with a 4-bit word will be 2^4, which is 16. Let's take an example for, let me just say, if k is 2, then 2^2 or 4 valid code words would be there. But if n is 4, for example, say n is 4, then we will have 2^4 code vectors. Code vectors possible. That means 16 code vectors are possible. But it's like this. Among 16, how many are valid? So I know I have a data word size of just 2 bits, right? Therefore, of 16, only 4 are valid. The remaining are invalid. Okay, so please remember this. The difference between n and k states there are few code vectors which are valid and the rest are invalid. That's what is shown here. Okay, moving on to distance properties of linear block codes. This concept of distance between code words and single error correcting codes, it was first developed by a person known as R.W. Hamming. And that's why we have a special code devoted to him, Hamming's code, a very beautiful code that is. Now, according to him, say we have n tuples alpha of having bits alpha 1, alpha 2 until alpha n, and beta having bits beta 1 to beta n. They are two code words. Then the Hamming distance between alpha and beta, denoted as d alpha beta, is defined as number of positions in which they differ. So what is the difference between these two code words in the bit positions? How many bit positions they differ? That states the Hamming distance. So alternatively, since we are always using mod 2 arithmetic, we can state that distance between alpha and beta is equivalent to summation j1 to n. Remember, they are n bit code words, both of them. Alpha j xor beta j, or modulo 2 added to beta j. So when I add these two, how many? I think all of us should remember what is xor operation. If I have 1 and 0 or 0 and 1, dissimilar bits, then I'm going to get 1 as the result. If they are same, if both are zeros or both are ones, 0 is the result. That's what we are trying to find out here, isn't it? We are trying to find out whether they are similar in the corresponding bit positions or whether they change. So if I simply do this modulo 2 addition or XOR operation, we'll be able to get, and if I take the summation for each of the bits, I'm going to vary the bit positions using this j variable, and if I take a summation in the end, I'll get the total number of bit positions in which they change. Okay, so this is about Hamming distance. Before taking some examples, let's also define what is Hamming weight. The Hamming weight W of a given code word alpha, it's defined as the total number of non-zero elements present in the code vector. So, equivalently, Hamming weight of a code vector is like measuring the distance between the given code vector and all zero code vector. So, let's take this example where we have alpha defined as 0 1 0 1 and beta defined as 1 0 1 0 1 1. Okay. Now you can see that, let me first find the weight. The weight of alpha, its weight is easy. Just count the total number of ones in the code word. Alpha is one code word. How many ones are there? 1 2 3 4 ones. Similarly, if I find the weight of beta, I have to check how many ones are there in beta. Again, I'm going to get 4 ones in the given code word. Then let's measure the distance between alpha and beta. As I told you, you can take bitwise XOR. Say the first bit is 0. Here the first bit is 1. So this is alpha 1 plus beta 1. This is alpha 2 plus beta 2. This plus is modulo 2. Okay. Likewise, you go on doing. So XOR operation 0 plus 1 would be 1. 1 plus 0 is 1. Here we have third bit positions, alpha 3 and beta 3 are both 1s. So 1 plus 1 would be a 0, so on. So if I add up all this, I'm going to get 4 as the answer, which means the distance between the two vectors is 4. Let's take another example. Say alpha is 1 0 1 1 0 1 1 1 and beta is 0 1 0 0 1 1 1 0. Okay, so this is given. Now a simple and easy way to find out this distance. How do I find this distance between alpha and beta? I just go on seeing whether the bits are similar or dissimilar. If you notice this position, it's dissimilar, 1 and 0. So that gives you a 1. To that you should add, second bit position are also different, add a 1. Third bit positions are different. Fourth bit positions are also different. Fifth bit positions are also different. Sixth and seventh bit positions are the same. So you don't add 1, you add 0. And 8th bit position is different. So there are 8 bits in both. So what do you get now? This is not XOR. This is just adding the total number of 1s. Just like here we have, it is just a plus. So you will be adding how many 1s are there? Totally, that gives you, because it's a summation operation, j is equal to 1 to n alpha j with beta j. So inside it is, this is an XOR operation. What we do here is XOR, but in the end I should add how many bits they differ. That gives me the distance between alpha and beta. So they differ in all those bits which are dissimilar, which yields a 1 when we do an XOR operation, which will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 bits. So the distance between alpha and beta in this example is 6. And you can see what? Weight of alpha is 6. and weight of beta is how many ones are there? 4. So I hope you understood the concepts of weights and distances. So again, the concept of Hamming distance, yeah, it's shown here. Some two more examples you can see. Okay, it measures the distance between two binary words. Let's take this 3-bit example. So the first bit is different, so there should be a 1. Second bit are same, so you add a 0. Third bit are same, add a 0. So totally, the distance between these two code words is just 1. Similarly, the distance between these two code words, the first bit is a 1. It's a change. Second bit is 0, same. Third bit is same, that's why 0. Fourth bit is different, 1. Fifth bit is different. Sixth bit is same. Seventh bit is different. So how many ones do I have here? 1, 2, 3, 4. Your answer for distance is 4. Now, why should we measure this Hamming weight and Hamming distance and all? The simple reason why you should do it is to determine the error detection and correction capability of a given block code, linear block code. Okay. It is very helpful in finding the error detection and correction capabilities. And in order to find that, we need to define another term called as the minimum distance daemon. So till now, what we defined was just distance between two code words. So what is this minimum distance? Minimum distance of a linear block code is the smallest Hamming distance between any pair of code words in the code. And usually the minimum distance can also be considered as the weight of non-zero code vectors in the code, and that too the smallest, the lowest weight of the non-zero code vectors in the code. Okay. So minimum distance is nothing but same as distance. Only thing, it should give you the smallest distance between any two code words in a code, between any pair of code words in a code. And usually it can be measured as the smallest Hamming weight of any non-zero code words in a given code. So please remember this. This is the easiest way of finding it. One way. Hamming distance is a metric function which satisfies the triangular inequality. Let's say alpha, beta, and delta are 3 code vectors in a linear block code. Then distance between alpha to beta plus distance between beta to delta should always be greater than or equal to distance from alpha to delta. This is called triangular inequality, and very important it is. It will be useful for the proof also. So I hope you understood. When there are 3 code words, distance from alpha to beta and then from beta to delta, this whole thing should always be greater than what? The distance from alpha to delta directly. So alpha to delta will usually be a shorter route. Whereas if I go from alpha to beta and then to delta, it will be a longer route. Something like this, alpha, beta, delta. So rather than going directly like this, if you go to beta first and then to delta, naturally, this combined route will be bigger than this direct route. That's what we mean to say. Also, we can just write that the distance between alpha and beta can be measured as the weight of alpha XOR beta. In the sense, if you look at this example, in the previous example, see here, we did alpha XOR beta. This is alpha, this is. And when we did alpha XOR beta, we got this. We have to obtain the weight of this. What is the weight of this? It would be 4. So after doing alpha XOR beta, whatever number I got, if I find its weight, that will tell me the distance. So this is another way of finding the distance. And actually there is a third way also. We'll just come to this. In this example, consider alpha and beta as given. So you have to find alpha XOR beta. 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1. I have to do an XOR operation. 1, 1, 0, 1, 0. Sorry, this is 1, 0. Right? Similar only in these two positions. So, what I'm after doing alpha XOR beta, I just have to find weight of this. What is the weight of this code vector? It is 4. Correct? So, this gives me the distance from alpha to beta. You can see distance from alpha to beta is given by this example. Now, he says, if delta is 101010, then you can try to prove those things. So, delta is 101010. What distance from alpha to beta we have already measured is 4. Then distance from beta to delta, let's measure. So, what is beta? 10 here. 1011. So let me try to find the XOR. This would be 0000. Only in one place they differ. So this is distance from beta to delta. Okay. Now what does the condition say? Distance from alpha to beta plus distance from beta to delta. 4 plus 1. This is 1. 5. Will it be the same as distance from alpha to delta? You can find out. Alpha is 0111 and delta is 101010. So XOR 1 1 0 1. I missed something. 1 1 0 1. Yeah. 1 1. So 1 2 3 4 5 6. So how many places? This is distance from beta to delta. The distance from this is beta. Okay, alpha. Distance from alpha to delta is 5, as you can see here. And distance from alpha to beta was already found 4, and distance from beta to delta we found it here 1. So here we are getting with equal to sign. Okay. But similarly, if I try to take the other way around, say distance from beta to delta, you take beta 101011, delta 101010. Here we saw just now distance from beta to delta. This will give you a 1 only in this position and 0 in all. So the answer to this is 1. Whereas distance from alpha to delta, distance from alpha to delta is 5. So this is 1 and this is 5, which will give you 6, which is greater than what? Distance from alpha to beta directly, which has been 4. So all these similar to that, the third triangular inequality can also be proved. Similarly, so taking all this into account, the minimum distance of a linear block code, which we call as d-min, it may be mathematically represented as the lowest minimum of distance between alpha to beta given alpha and beta belong to the chord C and alpha shouldn't be equal to beta. So it is the lowest of all the distances. So when we take alpha, beta in pairs, in a given chord word, there may be 10 chords, there may be 16 chords. So you just go on measuring the distance between pairs of chord words belonging to that chord with alpha not equal to beta. Then of all the distances measured, the lowest would be your d-min. So this is one way of doing it. This is method one. Method two is, you find the modulo 2 sum, XOR operation of the given alpha and beta values and find the weight of the sum. So you have taken XOR operation of alpha and beta, then you find the weight of that. But you will be doing this with pairs of code words. So you'll go on doing this with many pairs of code words and the lowest value which you get, that would be your d-min. Okay. So this is method two and this is method one. In method one involves finding distance between pairs of code words and in the end selecting the lowest. Method two involves finding the weight of the pairs, the XOR operation between pairs of code words and finally choosing the lowest weight. Better than these two techniques, we have a third technique where we can find the minimum distance by using the parity check matrix. So let's see how to do it using this example. Say this is the parity check matrix of a code. Let me try to find d-min for this. In order to find d-min, I have to add the columns of this matrix in such a way that I have to see that they add up to zero. Then count how many columns I have added to make it an all zero value. That would give you the d-min for the particular code. So let's see in this example. Say I'm going to add the first column C1 011 with, let me add it with C2 101. What am I going to get? 1. This is also a 1. 1 plus 1 would be a 0. This hasn't given me all zero value. So this I should again add it to. If I add this to C3, what is C3? You can see column 3 is 110. So again, when you do modulo 2 addition, what do you get? Now you're getting the all zero value. So how many columns have we added? We have added C1, C2, C3, totally 3 columns added. So totally 3 columns are added, which means d-min is 3. In this case, d-min is 3. So this is the third method of finding d-min, and this is one of the most useful method of finding the minimum distance of a code word. Now, with all these basics, let's try to understand what is error detection and correction capabilities in a given linear block code. As we have already discussed, the minimum distance of a linear block code is the most important parameter and it helps in finding the error detection and correction capabilities of a code. Say for example, I'm going to consider a 3-bit code word which is plotted along the vertices of a cube. See, all zero value, then I have 001, then 010. We have just taken them arbitrarily. Okay, we know with 3-bit we'll be having 2^3 8 combinations, right? So all the 8 values are plotted along the vertices of a cube. Now let's try to understand what is the effect of error in these things. Say for example, I group the code words 000, 101 here, 101, 110 and 011, these four. Say for example, I'm going to take these four code words in a group, then you can observe clearly the Hamming distance between the words is 2. The distance between these two, they differ in 2 bits. The distance between these two, this is first bit is common, second and third are different, they differ in 2 bits. Distance between these two are also 2. So however you take, you observe the distance between these, whether I take from here to here, is always 2. Okay. Now, let's say there was an error in the received vector. Okay. Now, what happens when there is an error? What happens? It will locate the words on the vertices of the cube, which are not code words, and they may be recognized as single errors. Say, if I have an error in 000, a single bit error means it can either give it as a 010 or what? 001 or 100. So for 000, when I say single bit error, what will be the values? Single bit errors are 001, 1 bit change, or 010 or 100. And if you observe 010, 001, 100, they lie very close to 000 itself rather than any other value. So, and all these three are not present on the vertices which we considered before. So they can be easily recognized as 1-bit errors. Okay. Say, for example, next, we have a code word pairs 000 with 111. Okay, let me just erase this. So that we'll not get confused. So next we are going to pair 000 with 111. Then 100 with 00011. So 000 with 111, 100 with 011. We are taking the opposite vertices, opposite corner vertices. 101 with 010, 010 with 101, and 001 with 110. Okay. So for example, now if a code word 000 is received, so as I told you, 000 can either be received as 001, 010 or 100 when we say there is an error, right? So you observe the positions 001 010 100, as I told you just now, they are much more closer to, all these are much more closer to 000 rather than 111. So in this given pair, if I have single bit errors, it will easily be identified that the error would be at when it started at this point, and it could be easily corrected. Okay, so Based on this, let's come to a generalized rule of error detection capacity. Say we have an n comma k linear block code, and this code needs to detect and correct all error patterns over a binary symmetric channel whose Hamming weight w is less than or equal to t. That means if we are going to transmit a code vector alpha and the received vector is beta, then alpha plus e represents the error. Okay, we want the decoder output to be alpha bar or alpha cap equal to alpha, subject to the condition that the weight of the error vector is less than or equal to t. Okay, so based on this, again you assume there can be 2 power k code vectors, all of them with k bit word. 2 power k code vectors are possible and all are transmitted with equal probability. So the best decision for the decoder is to pick the code vector nearest to the received vector b. So the one which lies closest will tell you this may be the corrected one. Okay, we'll assume that few errors have occurred, just single bit or less, 2 or 3, very few number of errors have occurred, then their position, how close they are to the actual correct code vector is important. That's why measuring this Hamming distance and minimum distance daemon becomes very important. So if I should be able to detect and correct all error patterns of Hamming weight which is less than or equal to t, then d-min should be greater than or equal to 2t plus 1. Now, using this, we'll just use a simple analysis to prove this. So the proof is here. We know d-min should either be odd or even, and t should be a positive integer. So this d-min should lie between 2t plus 1 and 2t plus 2. It should be odd or even, we told. That's the reason we have used plus 1 and plus 2. Let delta be any other code word of the code. Then Hamming distance among alpha, beta and delta will surely satisfy the triangular property. Distance from alpha to beta plus distance from beta to delta should be greater than or equal to distance from alpha to delta. Suppose an error pattern t dash errors occur in the transmission of alpha, then what happens to the received vector beta? It differs from alpha in t dash places. So distance between alpha to beta now becomes t dash. Since both alpha and delta are code vectors, it follows that distance between alpha to delta is greater than or equal to d min, which should be greater than or equal to 2t plus 1. Okay. So if at all, as per the previous equation we had taken from alpha to beta, it is t dash. So by using this and the previous equation, these two equations, and simplifying, you'll finally be able to show that distance from delta to beta is greater than or equal to 2t plus 1 minus t dash. Hence, if t dash is less than or equal to t, then distance between delta and beta is greater than t. So what's the meaning of all this? If there is an error pattern of t or fewer errors, the received vector beta will be closer in its Hamming distance to the transmitted code vector alpha. So even if there are errors, it will be quite close to the transmitted code vector alpha. And hence, the way in which we have to determine these errors would be to find the minimum distance between the transmitted code word and the received word. So this is also called maximum likelihood decoding or minimum distance decoding. The other name for this is minimum distance decoding or maximum likelihood decoding. Okay, so based on this, again we could prove that the code won't be capable of correcting error patterns of weight greater than t. So I think this proof is not so important. We can also consider, to make our point clear, we can take one more illustration. Say for example, this alpha is represented with a circle drawn at a distance t, or with a radius of t, and delta is also drawn with a circle, drawn in a circle with radius t. Now both have equal radius, and we have constructed these circles around the points which represent the code vectors A and delta. So this represents A, the code vector. This represents the code vector delta. And if, as in this case, both these spheres are completely disjoint, or we call it as mutually exclusive. So this and this are completely mutually exclusive, then what? We easily say the distance from alpha to delta is greater than or equal to 2t plus 1. Okay. But in the second case, you observe that the two sets are not disjoint. In the sense, they depend or there is an intersection. So in this case, again, we have to be careful how we define the d value. Okay, next, what is of importance to us here is the error correction capability. So if a given code can detect up to d min minus 1 errors, so the error detection capability is d min minus 1. Finding d min though is it could be done by any of the three methods. Then the smallest distance between any pair of code words is minimum distance of the code, and it guarantees correcting all the error patterns which lie within this condition. So this is very important. So the value of the number of errors which can be corrected are less than or equal to half d min minus 1. So this denotes always the number of errors which can be corrected is d min minus 1 by 2. It denotes the largest integer, which will tell us how many errors can be corrected. The total number of errors that can be corrected are calculated through this equation, and the number of errors which can be detected would be d min minus 1. Okay, and all different codes, random error correcting codes, which have just t as 1, if they have their t as 1, we call it as single error correcting code, SEC, single error correcting code. Okay, so please remember, the most important things here are error detection capability. Detection capability is d min minus 1, and correction capability is d min minus 1 by 2. Okay, very important whenever we have to talk about various linear block codes and their uses. So let's just see something called as Hamming bound. This Hamming bound is another important parameter which tells us whether a code is perfect or not. So how does it do it? For an n comma k linear block code, we know the total number of syndromes possible will be 2 power n minus k, right? So we know in the H transpose matrix, whatever we have, they are the syndromes. So you have 2 power n minus k syndromes, including the all zero syndrome. What's the meaning of all zero syndrome? We all know the all zero syndrome represents a condition of no error. Then there is no question of detection or correction of that error, right? So what we are trying to do here is if j is the number of error locations in the n dimensional error pattern E, then we can find in general the value of ncj, because we don't want to directly how to determine, we want to know how to determine the number of error correcting capability based on this. So it can be, it would be able to detect so ncj. It's a combination ncj multiple error patterns, and it also follows that total number of all possible error patterns would be summation of this value, summation from j is equal to 0 to t ncj, where t is the maximum number of error locations in E. So the important conclusion here is, if an n comma k linear block code is to be capable of correcting up to t errors, then the total number of syndromes will not be less than the total number of all possible error patterns, which means we know we can have 2 power n minus k different syndromes. Okay, leaving the all zero, it will become 2 power n minus k minus 1. Anyway, let's include all possible. Let's say total possible is 2 power n minus k. This value should always be greater than or equal to the summation of ncj. Okay, so this is usually referred to as the Hamming bound. That means the total number of errors which can be corrected should always be less than the total number of syndromes possible in a given circuit. And this property is called as the Hamming bound. And any code, any linear block code which satisfies this equation with the equal to symbol, say if this becomes equal to, then we call it as a perfect code. So let's see how to understand this by solving this problem. Say we are given a 7,4 code. Find whether the Hamming bound is satisfied if it should be capable of correcting one error. So how do we solve this? We know here k is equal to 4. T, the number of errors, is given as 1. Right. Now 2 power n minus k means 2 power 7 minus 4 should be greater than or equal to summation j is equal to 0 to t, t is equal to 1, ncj or nj as we write. What is the meaning of this? J can vary from 0. So we have how much would this be? Sorry. On the left hand side, I'm going to get one second. Suddenly this pen is creating some problem. Okay, so left hand side we have 2 cubed, which is 8, and on the right hand side I should take j as 0 and j as 1, two different values. So what is the value of n? N is 7. 7c0 plus 7c1. So we know how to calculate combinations. 7c0 will be 7 factorial by 0 factorial into 7 minus 0 factorial. 7c1, 7 factorial by 1 factorial into 7 minus 1 factorial. I think this would give me 7 by 7, 1, plus this would give you 7 factorial by 6 factorial, which means it is equal to 7. I am going to get the answer as 8. Your left hand side was also 8. Your RHS is also 8 now. That means this code is surely a perfect code, because this inequality is satisfied with equal to sign. Okay. So this would turn out to be a perfect code. Let's stop here and let's continue in the next class.